Hi, everybody. Hi, Horst. How you doing? I pray that you are doing wonderful today. Today is the last week on our digging deeper on prayer.
Recording in progress.
So they can hear us.
Can you guys hear me? Yeah? Okay. Okay. And she did say to pray us in, right? But she did pray in, but I can go ahead and just do real quick. Father, as we approach you to the throne, we just want to acknowledge who you are. You are the great I am. You are everything that we need and that we want. You are anything and everything. Thank you so much for being our defender. Thank you so much for fighting our battles, that we don't have to go through those, but you can do it for us. We just are grateful for today and tonight's Bible study. We just ask the Holy Spirit to open our minds and our hearts to receive from heaven, a download from heaven that we will understand, and that word will grow into our hearts and we can put it in practice tomorrow. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So I just want to do like a little talk about what we have been talking the last couple weeks. We were talking about the Lord's Prayer, and I just wanted to mention that there's a lot of prayers skeletons and like prayers, how we should pray and we can pray in the Bible. But for this specific study, we're focusing on the Lord's Prayer. But I'm not saying that that's the only way that we pray. We've been studying and kind of like taking in pieces and understanding that God designed that prayer to be in the Word of God, so we can have an example and a model that we can follow, and that all these verses from the Lord's Prayer, it starts, you know, the first verses, it starts with worship, to worship, right? That's how we should we start our prayers, worshiping God. And then the second one, the second point that we touch in the Lord's Prayer, it will be it's the worship that we touch in the first verses, and then we do we recognize. There you go. It was double echo. There you go, Alicia. We recognize that we want to bring heaven to earth. We want to bring anything from God over here. So we are.
Okay. Yeah.
I muted you again, she said. Okay. So we do, we worship in God for who he is. And then we surrender to him. So it's first worshiping, then a surrender to God. His will be done. And we ask for his will, and we ask for guidance, and we want to walk with him. And so that's the surrendering part. And the last part, we recognize that it's a spiritual battle. So we go in those three areas in the Lord's Prayer, right? We go to worship God first, then we tell God your will be done, we surrender to him, and then we go into a spiritual battle, because we know that our battles, like we read that last week, are not flesh and blood, but is spiritual. So we have to recognize that part of it. Okay, so before we do our last part of the Lord's Prayer, before we go deeper into that, I wanna share with you guys. I want to share something so cool that I just that I was like, oh my gosh, when we really understand who we are to Christ And we're not just this like person, or that it was created with no purpose, and we don't have no we have a Father. So when we recognize who our Father is, and that we are his daughters and sons, and what we entail with that, it's just like when you have when your mom and dad, you know, has an inheritance and they passed away, they had to pass away for order you to cash that inheritance, right? To own that, to want all that, the life insurance or the inheritance or whatever is yours you're gonna possess. So that's why Jesus had to die on the cross, because it was the only way that we can claim our daughtership and our who we are, all the stuff that he had prepared for us, and our inheritance that we have. That was the only way, because it has to be a debt for us to claim it. So when we understand who we are, that is so important too. So it says, before we knew we needed him, God always knew he wanted us. Isn't it that make you feel so good that he wanted us? It says, before we knew we needed him, he always knew he wanted us. And we read a Power of Ephesians last time, but I have a new Ephesians. It's Ephesians 1-5. It says, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. This is God's master plan all along. It didn't happen just for coincidence, or just happened, or he was like, oh, I'm just going to do this. No, he had a master plan since the beginning. He predestined us for adoption to himself as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, because his will for us is always to give us the best of the harvest, the best of abundance, the best of blessings, the best of everything. Here in this little devotional that I was doing, it says, this is the person who was doing the devotional. I watched as two close friends prepare to welcome another little person into their world. They cleared the spare room and freshly painted the walls. They created a space in their home as well as their hearts for their arrival. This family of four was just one full call away from becoming a family of five through adoption. Adoption was a common practice in Roman culture too, one that Paul's readers in Ephesus will have been familiar with. In our reading today, the Greek word of adoption is weisotesia. This is a legal term used in Rome culture, whereby the person adopted legally becomes a son. In the eyes of the Roman law, there was no such a thing as adopted son. Rather, the adoptee was immediately given the same title, same status, and same legal standing as biological child. Wow, if we just see that in the Roman culture, when they adopted a son, they just not just change, or a daughter, they just not change their last name. It changed completely who the person is. So it says immediately was given the same title, the same status, and the same legal standing by biological child. So if the parents were Roman and they were adopting, let's say, a Jewish, and they have whatever they own, that whatever they possess, whatever, it was, that person will become the same. So with that said, when God adopted us, that means that we own everything that he owns too, like his inheritance. We are not just Yanidia, I'm a Christian, that said, no, I'm Yanni, I'm sorry, I said my whole name. Probably people's like, who's that? Yanni? It's not just Yanni, you know, she's a Christian. No, Yanni, she's a daughter of the Most High. She was created with the purpose and with the fulfillment of God. Everything that he owns, it's mine as well. And it's the same for you guys. And it is so good that it doesn't just given me a last name. Like when we get married, if we get our husband's last name, right? It's not just that, but it changes completely who we are. We're now that all says we're new creation. It says once the process of adoption was complete, the adoptee lost all rights and responsibilities associated with their old family. All previous family history was erased. Any outstanding debt were canceled. And instead, they received new rights and responsibilities as part of the new family. Wow. So, Aura Sen is canceled. Huh?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So good.
God is so good. So, our old selves, all our dead, all our filthiness, or our sin, it's canceled because we have a new last name. We have a new name. We belong to Christ, our Father. Yes, we're now the same person. So everything is erased, deleted. If God doesn't remember that, we should not do it because God already forgave us. We're a clean slate. That is so powerful. All previous family history was erased and any outstanding debts were canceled. Instead, they received the new rights and responsibility as part of the new family. We have the new rights as a believers, the new rights as a being of daughters and women of God. How powerful is that? I encourage you, sisters, that you walk with that right that you have. Don't feel less than anybody else because God is giving you that power, that blessing. You can walk with your head high and know who you are, who you belong to, the Father. Oh my gosh, the creator of the whole universe. This sonship is offered to all who believe. Notice how Paul used the plural pronoun us in his letter. This clarifies his message. The adoption was intended for both Jewish and Gentile believers. We are the Gentiles, right? Because I do have 3% Jewish. I did my ancestry and I have only 1% Jewish from Europe. I guess my dad's. Like, I don't know, it goes back to 300 years back. So one of my dad's family had Jewish blood. So for that, I am so grateful. But what I was saying is that it's for Jewish, God's people, chosen people, and from Gentiles, which we are, male and female. And today is for you and me. Yeah, it's for all of us. We become part of God's family. In Ephesians 1, Paul reminds us of our position, place, and purpose in the family of God. Those who are saved by faith in Christ are no longer slaves to the sinful past. Hallelujah. We are safe and redeemed. Rather, it says Romans 5:12, 6:22. Rather, in a beautiful exchange, we are permanently and securely positioned in the family of God and given the full title, status, and inheritance as the one of his children. Romans 8:17 and Galatians 4:6-7, it tells us that it's a position only made possible through the blood of his son, Jesus. Ephesians 2:13. The phrase predestined for adoption means God decided in advance to adopt us. From this, we realize that adoption was not only God's idea. It was one of his very first ideas. Adoption was always God's master plan. It was not a backup plan or one forced into action to rescue a fallen world. Instead, adoption was an act of love initiated by a father who always wanted you and his family. It was not an afterthought, but a forethought. Before we knew we needed him, God always knew he wanted us. Adoption was intricately woven into the very blueprint of creation as the way he always wanted to be. Before God created the universe, he created space in his family just for you and me. Ephesians 1:4, before his hands were the hands of a creator, his care was the heir of a father. So in this, Ephesians 1:4 is saying, even before he created everything and everything, his heart was the heart of a father. He was thinking about us already before he even created anything else. He was just thinking of us. I just wanted to share this with you guys because it's so powerful to know all this information, and we can walk with confidence and know who our Father is and who we are. And that way, you can just take ownership and know that God already did his part. He sent his son to die in the cross for you. He already did. He already broke the ice. If you don't know where to start in your morning prayer, he already broke the ice. He already did his thing, right? So you just have to come and just talk to him, talk to him. He already did it. So I just wanted to encourage you guys to walk with this powerful knowing that you are chosen, that you are thought about it, that he is so in love with you and me and everybody else, that he thought about us even before the creation of the universe and the world and everything. Okay, so our last part of the Lord's Prayer, it is, remember when we read Matthew 6:9-13, it was a whole Lord's Prayer, right? But at the end, it was saying, after number 13, it says, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So we already talked about this one last Bible study last Thursday, that you know that we have to recognize and know that our battles are not just flesh and blood, but are spiritual as well. So we have to come and know our word, and know how to defend ourselves with the Bible, which is the sword, the word of God, so we can fight back and say, no, that's not true. This is who I am, and this is who I belong to. So buck up, right? So it was telling us that they think maybe later years after reading the Bible, I mean, writing the Bible and all that, maybe Christian people added, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So that's not actually in our Bibles, but Pastor Michael was teaching in this matter probably like a month ago or so, and he was saying that maybe that was added, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So that's what we're going to focus today, tonight. So kingdom, power, and glory, oh catalyst for your faith. God already knows his kingdom, power, and glory, the kind of unending releases our faith. This section of the prayer doesn't show up in early manuscripts of the Bible. So it's not in many of our modern Bible translations. It was probably added in the early Christian tradition. This addition is based on a blessing offered by King David in the book of Chronicles. So at the beginning, when I started the Bible study, I told you guys that the Lord's Prayer is not the only prayer that it's a model for us to like read it and know that we can follow that model. But also on Psalms, King David wrote a lot of Psalms. You know, if you are in need of a prayer, like he wrote so many Psalms, and he will tell God, you know, you're my redeemer, you're my defender, or he will go and pray for his accusers, or he'll go and pray for the people who was trying to kill him. He will be like, God, protect me. So any prayer that you might think, if you want to just exalt God for who he is and worship him for who he is, you can find prayers in there as well. Or if you want God to protect you, for protection, you want to pray for protection, and you want to pray for your enemies, everything is in there. So you can always go and read there too. There's a lot of good prayers. So We were talking about this edition is based on a blessing offered by King David on the book of Chronicles. All rule belongs to you, says in the scripture. All mightiness flows from you. Your victory shall be complete. There's a lot of good prayers in there of exaltation to our God, because God protected David over and over and over and over. He was persecuted for several years, and he was always on the run because King Saul wanted to kill him. So there's a lot of good worship and praise prayers in there. First Chronicles 29:11. This is the NIV. It says, "Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as a head over all." The Hebrew root of the word amen means true. And in ancient times, the Israelites were accustomed to ending their prayers by shouting amen, which means true. This word is also related to the Hebrew word emunah, meaning faith. Emunah applies to true faith. Matthew 6:9, NIV, it says, "This then is how should you pray." So that's how we started, right? Our beginning, this then is how you should pray. And then the Lord went to do the whole, the Lord's Prayer. And with that, I conclude the Bible study for tonight. I did want to mention something else that I did another devotional yesterday, and that was so good. I need to share. It was so, so good. Many of you might know C.S. Lewis, the guy who wrote the Chronicles of Narnia. I was reading actually his biography yesterday because of whatever I read in the and listened to the to my yesterday's devotional. So in the devotional was saying that he barely got married, right, with his newlywed wife, and is reading one of the books. I think it's a book called Joy or something like that. So his wife was named was Joy, and they were barely newlyweds, and they discovered cancer. So at this time he was going to the Oxford university. So he had a colleague or a teacher that he was atheist, right? So this atheist guy would always go see him going to the chapel. C.S. Lewis will go to the chapel and pray every day. And the guy said, "Do you really think that your prayers are going to change your outcome?" he asked. And then the guy, C.S. Lewis, said, I don't pray for my outcome to change," he say. "I pray because it changes me. And I was like, "Oh my gosh, that is so good, because it's so true. When we are praying and we're connecting with God, we're transforming into his image. We are just soaking ourselves in his presence, and we're becoming more like him. Our eyes are open to things that we would never think we can even see, right? We begin to hear with our hearts. We begin to see things. We begin to there's words of knowledge coming into us because we're stepping into that different. It's kind of like we are in another place, right? We just completely leave earth. I don't know how we it's just like that moment, one-on-one with the creator of the universe. It's like we are floating in the air, which is like gone. We are, oh my gosh, he's downloading new information. He's healing. He's breaking chains. He is healing generation and curses. And he is doing it all at that moment, right? So it's so good. It's so good. I just wanted to share that we pray because it changes us. We're doing it for us too. So I mean, it's a plus that we're talking to the creator of the universe, but it changed us too. So I love you guys. It was so fun to be with you guys these 4 weeks. I learned a lot too, believe it or not, when I go and watch the videos, God is speaking to me too. So God is so good.
Mom, we can't hear you.
Alicia.
No, we can't.
Get her off mute, Julia.
She's not on me.
It's not gonna.
Okay, so use Christina's phone, but make sure your computer's muted.
Is it echoing? Okay, there we go. Can you hear?
Yeah, we can hear you.
We can hear now. Okay. And then let me. There you go. Okay, ladies. I'm so sorry about this technical difficulties. This is the first time that mic is acting up. I'm basically just going to use Christina's phone as the mic. So you can hear me okay, you guys? Julia? Can you hear me? I can see you. Just say yes, Mom. Okay. Yeah, what I wanted to say was that God knows what he's doing. You know, God designed this, how this Bible study was going to happen. And he said that he wants us to sit at his feet and be discipled. And I really believe that that's what's been happening. Like Yanni taught, at the second Saturday of last month. And so here we are every Thursday going deeper, you know, on the topic of prayer. And so here we are now at the tail end. And at the end, ladies, be pondering right now what the Lord has shown you. Give a testimony if you have one, because he gets the glory, okay? He gets the glory. Also, I'm going to share a little bit. And Lydia, I'm going to turn it over to you if you have something you want to share. And then after that, then open it up if there's any testimonies that anybody wants to share. Just a word of encouragement or a little shout out to Yanni or whatever whatever you want to do. So I read out of the New King James Version, a new open Bible, and it is a red letter Bible. So everybody put up your hands, put up your high fives on your picture if you have a red letter Bible. Do you even know what a red letter Bible means? I'll explain. A red letter Bible means that Jesus's words
I can't hear. We can't hear.
Yeah, Christina went out. You have to unmute Christina so we can hear her.
Oh, what happened? It went on mute? Weird. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yeah, you can hear me? Okay. Sorry, I don't know what happened.
I didn't touch it. Did I touch it?
Nobody touched it. That's so
weird. Oh. But I do want to touch it. I want to move it that way a little bit. Okay. What was I saying?
Red letter Bible. Oh, yeah. Okay, so yeah, I was asking you guys to raise your hand if you have a red letter Bible. Red letter Bible is basically Jesus's words in red, which you're going to see in the four gospels. And as you know, we're reading one of the gospels, Matthew. So basically, those are the accounts of those apostles, you know, what they saw and heard. You know, they took record. Okay, so then we get to hear this. So I'm going to go ahead and jump to the verse that we went over today, and that is Matthew 6:13b. And I say B because A is the first part and B is the second part. So B says, "For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Okay, the word that popped out to me was yours. And mine's capitalized, which means he's talking about God, right? But as you know, like Julia said it in the comments just a little while ago, she says we're heirs, mm-hmm. because we are heirs, and we're heirs
oh my gosh. Christina, what are you doing?
I should turn this one on. I'm gonna turn this one on and just let it go. Yeah, that is weird. Like all of a sudden, it'll...
okay. I renounce this in the name of Jesus. I'm just gonna say it. I renounce the technical difficulties in Jesus' name. It's enough.
Amen.
I'm over it. Get out of here, Satan. You go.
Amen.
Okay, can you guys hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. So I just put my phone in front of me and I think we should be okay. All right, so what I also saw in this verse, and not just the verse, but the passage. In the passage, I saw Jesus's humanity as a man, only because he's like including himself. If you guys read that passage over again, he says us, he says our, he says we, you know, in those passages, because Jesus is God made man. Mm-hmm. And so when he's teaching them, you know, how to pray, like he's teaching from the perspective, well, because that's how I pray. He's saying, you know, he's calling him my father, our father, because he's our father. And Jesus honored his father, right? We should, yes, honor him as father as well. You know, in that verse, the verse 9, it says, our father in heaven. He doesn't say ours is the kingdom. He says yours is the kingdom. So he's not already claiming that the kingdom was his, even though technically it is, but he hadn't done what he was sent to do yet. And as you guys all know, he did fulfill that calling, and he is now sitting at the right hand of the Father. So now it's their kingdom. And not only that, now it's our kingdom. Like it's kind of mind blowing to think, mm-hmm. that, but it's true. As heirs. And you guys know how being an heir works, right? Somebody leaves you, you know, you're an heir, you inherit that. So we inherit that. The same, you know, promises, the kingdom. I want to jump to 1 Chronicles 29:11. Let me see. It says, yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, and the glory, the victory, and the majesty, for all that is in heaven and in earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. And this is David talking. So David here, he's proclaiming God's deity, God's dominion. And just look at those words that he's using. Greatness, power, glory, victory, majesty. And then he ends with head over all. I mean, that is the God that we serve. Like, that is, I don't know, for me, it was like, listen to that power. Like, this is the God that we serve. This is the King, right? He's the King. He's our King. He's our King, ladies. So think about it. Whatever you need, whatever you want, whatever you desire, take it to the King. Because if he's really who David says he is, which we know he is, you know, take it to the King in prayer. And we have that available at any given time. And nothing is too small that we can't take to the throne. Nothing. Take it to the throne. However, I want to go over what we should do. If we're going to the throne, first we should repent. So anytime we go to our secret place, you know, our time with God in prayer, we should repent first. Always start with repentance, ladies. It's so important because you got to think about who you're coming to. We just talked about, the, you know, David just said who it is that we are actually praying to. So we need to come to the throne and we need to first repent. When we go to pray, repent first. And then make your request known. So go to your Heavenly Father in prayer, just as our forefathers did, right? Mm-hmm. Think about, you know, the Bible story. Okay, so who went to God in prayer? You know, David did, you know, Daniel did, you know, and the list goes on. We can list how they all went to God in prayer. We can too. And then guess what? It's the same God, the same God. If you guys think about the stories in the Bible, the God that they are praying to and worshiping and serving is the same God that we are praying to, the same God that we are worshiping. I mean, it is, talk about, you know, developing, you know, a relationship and intimacy with, you know, the Most High God. What is better than that? There's nothing better than that. Nothing. I can't think of anything. Any relationship, nothing. So another verse I want to go to is 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. And it says, now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. And so here is Paul giving God high praise. That is what God desires. That is what God deserves, and nothing less. That is the God we serve, ladies. That's the God we serve right there. The same God that Paul is praising, the same God that David's giving, you know, honor to. You know, it's verses like these, ladies, that really help us to clearly understand how and why we believe the scripture that says, if God is for us, who can be against us, right? If you really know who God is and believe who God is, no matter what situation, what circumstance, whatever it is, if God is for you, Lisa, if God is for you, Clemencia, Victoria, Adriana, Christina, if he's for you, what can be against you? What can be against you? Nothing, right? and you have, and all you ladies too on Zoom, you say your name, you know, if God is for Alicia, who can be against me? Because God is for us. He is for us no matter what. It's not conditional. It's not circumstantial. So Romans, do what Romans 12:12 says. Keep on praying, because you may be in a situation or circumstance. You're like, but I did pray. Well, guess what? Romans 12:12 says you need to keep on praying. Mm-hmm. Keep on praying. And while you're praying, do these things. Psalm 150, verse 1 says praise. Praise God while you're praying. While you're praying, do as 1 John 1:9 says, confess. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from what? All unrighteousness. I saw your lips, Lydia. You go, girl. Yes. So when we pray, confess. Do what 1 Samuel 1:17 says. Petition. Petition. Petition in faith. Petition in the name of Jesus. That's what Eli said to Hannah. If you remember, Eli says to Hannah, go in peace. The God that he heard you. And he was going to grant her petition, he said to her. We have that same freedom. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's the same thing available to us. Mm-hmm. Same thing. When we go in prayer, do as Philippians 4:6 says, give thanks. Be anxious for nothing. Who can finish it?
Anxious for nothing.
But in everything.
What is it, 6?
Mm-hmm.
Ephesians or Philippians.
Yeah, Philippians 4:6. With prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Mm-hmm. So with thanksgiving, okay? So when we pray, make sure we're giving him thanks. Because remember, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So if you're giving him thanks, that's a humble thing to do, right? If you're mm-hmm. thanking somebody, you're humbling yourself.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So let's do what Proverbs 16:3 says. Commit your works to the Lord and your thoughts will be established. So when you go in prayer, commit yourself to the Lord. You know, commit yourself to him. Let him know when you're praying, you let him know that you want to dedicate yourself to him, your life, you know. Commit yourself to the Lord. So the last thing. So our God is the only God, ladies, that actually gives answers.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember the stories in the Bible where they're like praying and they're doing this and they're, you know, trying to work up to their false God for their God to show up and do something, you know, didn't work. God is the only God who actually answers prayer, petitions. All the false gods ain't got nothing on God. And praise God, all you ladies on this Zoom, all you ladies here, you found the one true God.
Amen.
There's a lot of ladies out here right now. They haven't found the one true God. Mm-hmm. Not yet, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus.
But each of you has found the one true God, the one God that does hear your prayers, the one God that can do a miracle in your life, the one God that can heal whatever you're going through. You know, believe it. Receive it. So yeah, as we close in prayer, I mean, this is so good. This is just, it should be just rousing us up, like, let's go. more prayer. But I will pass it on to Lydia. Did you have anything you wanted to share, hun?
Thank you, Yanni, for stepping up and
Amen.
Being obedient to God. You know, it's not an easy thing to speak in public. You have to be very courageous to speak in public because you are being evaluated and critiqued the whole time. And so, you know, you are a brave woman of God, and I'm very proud of you for doing what you did. And then to make the commitment to do the Bible studies every Thursday. It's a big commitment. It doesn't seem like a lot, but even being an attendee is a big commitment. I mean, there was some days, you know, that I was like, oh, do I really need to go? We just had prayer last night, you know, and you committed so to that, you know, and so thank you very much for bringing the word and bringing this very much needed topic about prayer, Yanni. We all need it. You know, we need to be praying every day, all day. You know, it's a habit. We have to form that habit to pray to our big God. You know, you started out with talking about his name, Yahweh, you know, Jehovah. You know, I was trying to say it in Hebrew, but I can't. But you taught us his name, and it's so important to pray every day, because because prayer is meditation, and you're either meditating on something good or you're meditating on something bad, you know. So when we're praying, we're meditating on something good. We are repeating what God says about us, what God says about how he has our back, how he has our children, how he has our lives, our husbands. We are repeating, like regurgitating back to him what he is saying. So that's meditating and praying good. You can also be praying and meditating something bad, what the devil is saying. You're just regurgitating what the devil is saying, because the devil will speak to us in our mind, right? He'll come and say, you know, you nobody's going to listen to you. You're ugly. You're too fat. You're too skinny. You're too short. You're too whatever, you know, all these things. You know, your marriage isn't going to survive. You know, your husband doesn't love you. You're so unhappy. So as we're hearing those things, right, and we start to repeat them and believe them and speak that or we're speaking our fears, you know, and God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind, that sound mind, so that we can speak the truth. What truth? What we're praying, the Bible, the truth about what we have inherited. He went to that cross. You know, we just finished talking about all that, but I think you get the gist of what I'm trying to say. Either you're praying good or you're praying bad. You're meditating on good or you're meditating on bad. It's one or the other. You know, I could be washing dishes and all of a sudden this ugly thought comes, not so much, you know, anymore. Some days I feel like I crush them immediately, because as soon as, you know, thought comes to my head that says, you know, your sister, your sister says this or that, or, you know, you're ugly, or she doesn't look at the way she looked at you. Look at the things she said about you. And instead of me going with that and saying, you know, starting to think about that, wow, she did say that. She did look like that. They did say that, you know, it is happening. It's not a good thing, right? Instead of doing that, you know, I flip the tables on the devil, and I just start lifting her up in prayer. I thank you for my sister. I thank you that you bless her, that you protect her, put a hedge of protection around her, Lord. Bless her today, God. She needs you. She is coming under attack. She's coming under attack, not only by the devil, but by me, because as soon as they speak that word, he speaks that word into my mind and I go with it. Guess who's going to start attacking her? Me, by repeating what what he said, which is a lie, right? Or maybe it's true, who knows? They still need prayer instead of going with that negative, flip it on the devil and pray for that person. And the habit of prayer all day long. You're washing dishes, start praying in tongues, you know, or there's so many things to pray for, our children, our church, our pastors, our leaders, our friends, you know, so much, our businesses, you know, our ministries. So thank you for the reminder, Yanni. We love you. I love you so much. You have blessed me. You don't even know how much you bless me with your words, with your time. And it's everywhere. The women, we're just going crazy over here, Yanni. We love you, sister.
Thank you, Lydia. Go ahead, Julia. Take yourself off mute, hon.
So, yeah, I just wanted to go along with what everyone's been saying about prayer and share something that God has revealed to me about prayer. It has to do with praying according to not only who you know God is, but also according to who you know you are. Identity is so important when it comes to praying. You need to know that you are an heir, you are a child of God, asking your father for something. If I were to ask my parents, my father or my mother, for something that I need, they love me that they, it's not even like a second thought for them. Like, they would just give it to me, right? So when we go to the Father for something, we are not begging. We don't have to beg for anything. Only dogs have to beg for what's on the table. And even Jesus makes reference to the children's bread. And what he was referring to was the inheritance for those who are children of God. There is something that is automatically for us once we become co-heirs with Christ, once we receive salvation, like Yanni said, our identity just changes. And what we need to do is we just need to step into that identity. We need to go into the Word and say and read what the Word says about our identity. I would highly recommend the book of Romans. I think Paul lays it out very clear how we are supposed to function now that we are in a time after Jesus has already finished it. So now there's a certain way we are to live. There's a certain way we are to pray because of who we are, because of this new identity that we've been given, because we're heirs and we need to understand what is a part of our inheritance. Something that God highlighted to me about the prodigal son, you know, about that whole story that Jesus was talking about. He highlighted to me about the brother that stayed with the father. He never strayed, always did what the father told him to do, was always working for the father, and he gets angry, actually, that he said, I've been here and you have not given me even a goat to celebrate with my friends, but yet you kill the fattened calf for this son of yours. And he literally says, this son of yours. He doesn't even reclaim him as a brother, but he's like, this son of yours, you killed the fattened calf for him. And he wasted the inheritance. And it's actually in Luke chapter 15 and verse 31. And this was the father's reply to him. He said, look, dear son, you have always stayed by me and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but now he is found. And so the father is like, what do you mean? Like, I haven't given you a single goat to celebrate with your friends. Everything I have is yours. You see, the son that stayed in the house and was always working, he actually didn't understand what his inheritance was as a son. And so he's like, you haven't even given me a goat. And the father's like, everything I have is yours. You can have whatever you want because you've stayed with me, because you've been faithful. You can come to the Father and pray for whatever you need. And we can't even complain, oh God, you didn't give me this, God, you didn't give me that. Our inheritance is everything we could possibly need. When we seek first the kingdom of God, everything is added unto us. Everything we could ever need. It's just added. It's just extra when we seek first the kingdom of God. And that has to do with our identity as heirs. And I want to make one more Bible reference. I really love this verse. It's Mark 11, verse 24. It says, therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. And those are Jesus' words. And if Jesus says it, I believe it. Whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. I thought about why do we close our eyes when we pray? Why do we bow our heads? It's because we know that what we're praying for is not something that can be seen. The things that we pray for are by faith. We don't pray according to what we see in our circumstances. We don't pray according to what provision we can see in our lives. We pray according to what we cannot see. And that is by faith. And so I just want to encourage you, you know, when you pray, know that you don't have to convince God to heal you or to heal somebody. You don't have to convince God to provide for you. He is your Father and he loves you and he wants to give it to you anyway. So believe that you have received it already when you pray for it, and it will be given to you. So that's what I wanted to say.
Amen, amen, amen.
Good. We want to clap over here. Can we clap?
That was so good.
You guys can clap on the
little clap emoji or whatever. All right. Does anybody else have anything they want to share? Don't be shy. And I can't see everybody, so. Yeah, just take yourself off of mute and go ahead and share because I can't see everybody. I'm limited on my Chromebook.
Leave you on top.
Right here?
Gallery.
Okay. All right. So what I need each one of you ladies to do, and you got you ladies here, write down a number. I'm going to do a giveaway real quick. Write down a number between 1 and 40. The ones on Zoom, you have to type it in the chat. The ones in Zoom, type it in the chat. And let me show you what I'm giving away.
Typing in the chat.
Let's see.
I have one.
Girl, read your Bible cup. Filled with some goodies.
Let me turn on the light so you can see it. Can't really see it very well.
No?
I can't see it.
Don't say your number. You gotta type it in the chat. Somebody gonna take your number.
My chat's not coming up.
What?
The chat's not coming up for me.
No? Okay, I'll write it down. Okay, so give me your name and your number then. Actually, I'll put it next to your name. I already wrote your name down. Who was that?
Margie.
Margie, what number, hun?
Right there. You got it?
No.
Yes,
you got it.
All righty, thank you.
Okay.
I already wrote my list down.
Okay. All right. Did everybody already give me your number? Okay, over here. You got okay, Tori. What's your number?
Oh no, I got. Okay.
She's so confident she's gonna win.
What?
If you win, you bless somebody. If you don't want it, what's your number?
Oh, it was 1 through 40.
1 through 40.
23.
Lisa.
Yeah, Michael Jordan.
25. No. Adriana.
27.
Six. Okay. I believe everybody has their numbers in, especially the ones here. This is my number.
Wow. Ah!
Someone got 7 on here.
Those two.
So. Yeah, Margie got 7.
I had 7. I won.
Yanni had 7. Oh, they both had 7.
Good thing, because guess what?
We won.
We got 2 winners, Yanni and Margie.
Yay.
All right, I will be taking it to church on Sunday. Congratulations! Just a little bit of fun. Just a little bit of fun. You're welcome, honey. All right. So let's see. Julia, you want to pray us out, hun?
Yeah.
Her smile. If not, you have to choose somebody else.
Julia, you were wonderful.
Okay. Thank you.
She's so happy,
but... All right. Thank you, Jesus, for this time together, as coming together as women of God, talking about prayer, Lord. We thank you for Yanni, first of all, for stepping out in faith and being willing to teach us about prayer, Lord. Thank you for the revelation that you've given her, and thank you for how you've used her and spoken through her for this past month, Lord. Right now, I just pray blessings upon her. Right now, I pray that you would give her a double portion, Lord Jesus. Thank you for her life, Lord.
Yes.
And I just want to pray blessings over her children and her husband as well, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you. We thank you for her obedience, oh God. And I just want to pray a blessing over all the women under the sound of my voice, Lord. I want to pray that you would continue to give them revelation, oh God, from your word, oh God. And I pray that you would use us wherever we are in our circle of influence, oh God, in our families, among our friends, in church, Lord Jesus. I pray that you would use us to be your hands and feet and to be your mouthpiece, oh God.
Yes.
I pray that we would go higher in prayer, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
I pray that as we become more spiritually mature, Lord, that we would begin to access new realms, Lord, in your power through prayer, oh God. I pray for increased faith, God. Increase our faith as we pray, Lord Jesus, so that we may believe that we have received already what you have in store for us, Lord.
Yes.
All the inheritance that you have for us in the kingdom of God, Lord, we take it. We take that authority. We take that power. Yes. And I just pray that over every woman, oh God.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes.
And I also pray over their families right now, Lord Jesus. I pray over their marriages. I pray that you would bless them, oh God. And I pray that you would even take their families to new heights in their spiritual maturity, Lord Jesus. I just pray for increased revelation, oh God.
Yes.
So I just pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Julia.
Yes. Amen.